Paul Thurrott and Rafael Rivera. Welcome to the Leanpub Launch video, our very first one.
Wow.
Yay!
Yeah, thanks very much for being here. So you guys are the authors of brand new book, Windows 11 Field Guide. And Paul, I was wondering if you could start off by telling us who the book is intended for.
Well, it's intended for anyone who's going to be upgrading from Windows 10 to Windows 11 or buying a new computer that has Windows 11 on it. So it's kind of grown in scope. I originally planned to start to get this started last year and then change the formula, move things around. And suddenly now I've dedicated my next 6 months to a magnum opus of sorts. So
For anybody watching, the book is currently about 450 pages or something like that in the PDF. And it might expand to 1,000, as you guys say in the book description.
It could very well.
And it's already like 300 pages over
what it needs to be.
It's a comprehensive field guide, that's for sure. And you mentioned Paul, that it's partly for people upgrading from Windows 10 to Windows 11. So you've actually included as a digital extra your previous bestseller of the Windows 10 Field Guide in the purchase of this book.
Yeah, one of the nice things about Leanpub, as you know, is that you can publish your book in progress, and that's great. I wanted to get the first version out that had most of the new stuff in Windows 11, but there's a lot more that is identical to or very similar to what's in Windows 10. So to give it more of a complete appearance or a complete experience, really, for people who buy the book, I give them the previous book. We give them the previous book, and that way they can check out the other chapters that aren't quite, you know, updated yet for Windows 11.
And Rafael, when did you guys get started working on the book? I know that Windows 11 was sort of formally launched last October, I think.
Right. So this actually goes all the way back to Windows 7 Secrets back in 1980. No, it was actually, I looked at the date today and I can't believe it was 2009.
Yeah, that's right.
I started working with Paul on kind of documenting Windows then, and I've been stuck on the roller coaster since. Although he's taken more of the front seat and active role in doing all the heavy lifting there.
I want to be really clear. I couldn't do this without Rafael. And I was trying to remember if you started on Vista or 7, because we had done those print books back in the day. But Windows 7 Secrets was 1,000 pages for sure.
That was crazy.
Windows 8 Secrets was not, because that release was ridiculous. But then after that, we wanted to move to more of a self-publishing electronic book type format. So,
yeah. And we figured, you know, we can do what those editors do. Do it ourselves. And then,
No, it's interesting. And actually, I'm curious about how you collaborate, actually. So I believe you're using our GitHub writing mode. So do you guys do like branches and pull requests and stuff like that?
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, that's actually a big part of what Rafael set up for me, because he understands that and I don't. So I actually update the book, whether I'm doing a preview or the publish, it's all through GitHub command line interfaces. And I have a cheat sheet, but it works incredibly well. So yeah, we use GitHub for that.
That's great. Actually, speaking of things that work well and Windows and a long time ago, so this is totally random, but in 1995 in the summer, I was in Delhi and I attended the official Microsoft launch of Windows 95.
Right.
And I remember being just blown away by one part of the demo, which I think was video in the browser. They were playing a Weezer video, I think it was.
It was just video. Actually, it's so long ago, it's hard to even remember this, but that was some, I don't remember the format anymore, but
I think it was MPEG 1.
Yeah, it was a tiny 320 by 200 or 240 video. And it was the Weezer song that took place on the set of Happy Days.
Right. And I was actually second guessing myself. So it actually wasn't in the browser. The amazing thing was just being able to watch video on your computer.
You could, exactly. Yep. You could have multiple videos if you wanted. I think there was a skiing video.
Yeah.
There were two or three.
On the CD-ROM too.
Yeah.
I guess my sort of the question that leads me into is there anything magical like that in Windows 11?
No. No, it's a it's a different world. I mean, I think Windows 11 was conceived in many ways during the pandemic and that whole hybrid work environment that we're now sort of still settling into. To me, the big advance there is they took the solid foundation of Windows 10, which is great, and just made it more of a simple kind of mobile-like experience for the most part. Part of the reason we didn't put out something last year, honestly, was because it shipped initially in pretty incomplete form, and I felt a little uncomfortable about that. They've improved it over the course of this year. So they've had a few little minor releases. They updated it again in October and then actually again this past week. So it's finally getting to the point where I think the big complaints are starting to be addressed finally. And it's kind of there now for most people that want to upgrade.
Yeah, speaking of complaints, so I listened to a couple of interviews that you've done, and mm-hmm. of course you do, you know, you have your weekly podcast and stuff like that where you go in depth about everything. But you know, just because you're writing books about Windows operating systems doesn't mean you're not critical of them,
right.
and you wouldn't write about them if you didn't care about them. But that doesn't mean you're going to say everything positive. And there's one really curious feature in Windows 11 that you write about the widgets. Mm-hmm. That have a very kind of, I have this kind of joke, like, you know, apologies. Many of my best friends have MBAs, but I have this joke about the vanilla MBA feature. And one of those, I think, is present in the widgets where you can have these kind of like little dashboard features that when you click them, they only go to Microsoft services.
That's right. Correct? Yeah, that's part of the dark side of Windows 11. And, you know, I this is something I think about, write about, and talk about a lot. And I'm trying to come to terms with it. But the way to think of this is that people aren't upgrading their computers every 3 to 5 years anymore. The computers last a long time. Windows has been a free upgrade now, assuming you have supported hardware, for a long time now. So Windows 10 was free to most people. Windows 11 is free to anyone who's basically a computer that was made in the past 4 or 5 years. Microsoft still wants to monetize that really large community of people out there. And so they're trying different ways. I don't think this type of thing is maybe the right way to do it, but it is a sad fact that in Windows 10 and 11, actually, that you could choose your own browser, Chrome, Brave, Firefox, whatever it might be. And there are certain things in the UI that will still trigger Microsoft Edge, even though you've said, I don't want to use that product. And so, yeah, widgets is one of them. Search highlights is one of them. And there's no great workaround, but this is one of the topics that does come up in the book. In fact, I would say this is the first book, you know, I've been writing books now for 25 something years, where there's a little bit of an editorial component to it. I've tried to separate those things because this is a reference and it's meant for people, you know, help people get up to speed with the product. But I think it's something people have to know about. It's just a sad reality of the, you know, the world we live in that they, you know, they're trying to monetize it, which I completely understand, but they're doing it in ways that maybe aren't consumer friendly.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was sort of reflecting on that and how, you know, this isn't an original observation, but how that experience of feeling monetized might be something that we're all so familiar with nowadays that we don't, maybe sort of people who aren't as old as we are don't get mad at, don't shout at the computer when that happens because they're just like, well, that's welcome to Facebook, you know?
That's whatever. Right. Yeah. There is an element of old man shaking his fist at the cloud, but all I can do is say, look, this is what's happening. Just so you know, if you're okay with it, you're okay with it. You know, it's fine. There are people who are going to choose to use Microsoft Edge. They won't notice this. So that's a choice you could make. It's fine. Edge is fine, you know, but.
Just to say something positive, Rafael, mm-hmm. for example, what are some of your favorite sort of new features in Windows 11?
Favorite new features.
As spoken as the person who's reverse engineering it to work with the products you make on for work.
You know? Yeah, that's true. So just to go back, clarify that, I currently work at Thurrott Corporation, which is kind of this consumer focused company that builds software to fill in gaps left behind by Windows and kind of some of their decision making there. So to answer that question, favorite features. You mentioned widgets. Widgets are interesting. right now, they are somewhat hard to love. Right. However, they are now getting developer extensibility options there. There's an API now. You can write your own widgets. So now when you click them, they don't go straight to Edge or go straight to Bing or whatever. They could maybe, you know, sound a bell or connect to some other services that you have on the back end. So that's an interesting space for me. That's pretty neat. What else? I'm an ultra wide monitor user. And so the centering of the centering of start and the button and the taskbar items and some other surfaces is a dream come true because it would be
Because
all the
otherwise it
way over
was way
here.
over
Otherwise, yeah,
there.
you'd have to turn your head and get like burn 10 calories just turning. That was extremely annoying. Other than that, like Paul kind of alluded to earlier, Windows 11 is more of a kind of a polishing of the Windows 10 foundation, which is always kind of nice.
Actually, it's
Yeah,
interesting you
I
brought
don't
up
think
the
there's a big bang feature, right? I think it's just a bunch of little things.
One of the interesting things you brought up there, developers. I mean, the one of the interesting things about your work is Paul and Rafael is, for sort of an ordinary consumer of things like me, to actually understand like all the different perspectives that are being brought to bear on the creation of an operating system. For example, most people aren't going to be ultra wide screen, power users. And so it's sort of you end up with this kind of like 1% of people who kind of really, really sort of have a sort of high demand for everything to work really well. Whereas for a lot of people, it's like, as long as Word can keep up with my typing, I'm kind of happy. And it's which as I gather it sometimes even to this day, can't always do that. Which is crazy. But I guess this is one just to bring up a sort of personal hobby horse of mine. I really hate having things being hidden from me that are crucial. So Gmail, for example, like my joke about Gmail is like if you've sort of half joke is if you've ever had a job where you can go to jail for sending an email to the wrong address, Gmail makes you very, very frightened, right? Because it'll hide the email address and replace it with the name. And it's like, as everyone on Twitter is finding out, you can write any name you want there. It's the address that matters.
The world is going in a bad direction for you because that's all over the place now too.
It is. Okay. Including in
In
Windows.
Windows, yeah, for
Yeah,
sure.
I was thinking of the mail app while you were talking.
Yeah, that's really unfortunate to hear, but there we go. Hopefully we can reverse the tide with books and podcasts.
I mean, for now at least, Windows is at least configurable. I think one of the nice things about it is you can go in and usually, not in all cases, but you can make changes to make things the way you want. The trick is knowing where those things are, and then God help you if you have to move between different computers because you have to recreate a lot of the stuff. It doesn't really do a good job anymore of syncing settings, which is something, one of the few good things that came out of Windows 8 and really has kind of fallen by the wayside, unfortunately.
My instinct is to do hour and a half long podcast interviews. That's what I've been doing for like 10 years now. But since this is our first launch video, I'm going to really try and keep it a little bit short, because the idea here is so that people don't have to commit to sort of like feature length experience to sort of learn about you and your book. But so my last question is, you are going to be publishing more content. Do you have a kind of worked out cadence or anything like that, or is it just going to be, occasional?
Yeah, what's the
It's
schedule, Paul?
So, but there should be new content every week. I just put up two more chapters last night, actually. I don't have an exact schedule. The weird thing about the way I write, maybe this is the way other people write, is you don't start on page one and write to page 500, right? There are different topics, different areas. So I'll dive into parts of the book that are kind of in the back. In the beginning, I wanted to, like I said, I wanted to get that core bit done that was most of the new stuff, and that's kind of up front in the book. But the rest of it is going to be kind of put in, in different order. So I'll try to do section. I'm writing the Microsoft Edge section right now, which is a horrific experience. But once that's done, I'm going to probably move back and forth through the book. So I don't know the exact schedule, but you can expect some number of new chapters every week for sure. For sure.
Great, fantastic. Well, thanks very much for appearing on our very first launch video. I'll make
Yeah,
sure
you
to put
bet. Thank
links to
you.
you guys and all of your work and everything important in the description of the video. And yeah, thanks very much for being here.
Yeah, thank you for having
Thanks,
us. And
Len.
thanks for the service. It works. It's fantastic.
Oh, thanks.